I was scheduled to speak today, and I've been thinking about a sermon that I've wanted to give, and that is loving God without being religious. It's something I've been working on for some time, loving God without being religious. But as I saw what was happening today with the time and everything, today is set aside for us to have the Lord's Supper and a couple other things that we wanted to celebrate with Don and Paula being here. We're going to take some time instead to just have some devotional thoughts about the Lord's Supper, and then we're going to partake of this special time. We do this here in our church, for those of you who are new, once a month. There's nothing in the Bible that says that's when you should do it. It's just something that we have decided we would do it monthly. Some churches do communion every week. Some do it quarterly. Some have other ways in which they celebrate the Lord's Supper. Today, we don't want to rush. We get feedback that sometimes we rush communion. And so we're going to have a little more time in order to participate in this particular event. I've been reading and greatly blessed from a book called True Faced. And thank you very much, sir. You're not Scott. This is a book, True Faced, and it's written by three different men, and one of them was a speaker at our Navigator staff conference a year ago. And next Sunday morning, we have our adult Bible fellowships that take place at a quarter of 10. We've got this new time system here. And we're going to have all the adult Bible fellowships together to watch this video of this message that this man gave. And I would encourage you, if you never attend any adult Bible fellowships, or if you do, be here for that one. This is a message you'll want to hear. It is one of the most encouraging, one of the most uplifting messages you will have. Because in this, John Lynch will talk about what grace means, what love of God, what we've been singing about here, is about. And we tend to sometimes not really bask in the salvation, the joy, the love that God has for us. Let me read a few statements that he asked about these questions, about what it means when you know Christ, when you know the love of God in Jesus Christ. He said, may I dare risk that God actually means I'm a new creature right now? May I dare believe that God is crazy about me right now? May I dare believe that God never, ever leaves my side, no matter how bad I get? May I dare believe that I'm not on God's B team? That means I'm on his A team. May I dare believe that I don't have to do penance after I fail? May I dare believe that I don't have to put on appearances because God knows exactly the pace of my maturity? May I dare believe that I am considered righteous right now, even though I still act out in wrong ways? May I dare believe that I am godly because I share this new nature, fused with the God of the universe? May I dare believe that God doesn't keep a logbook of my offenses, bringing them up to me from time to time? May I dare believe that God is never disgusted with me? May I dare believe that God is never ashamed of me? May I? Do you believe that way? How would you answer some of those questions? Do you know that God loves you? And in his love for you now, it will never be any greater? Do you know that? God's love that he has for you and me right now will never be any greater than what it is. Oh, it'll be the expressions of it we can tap into. The manifestation of it we can grasp. But his love, I am loved with an everlasting love. That is there. It's for me to embrace. It's for me to find out. And guess what? We have an enemy called the devil who sits over here and just throws all kind of lies. You're really not that good. You're really not loved that much by God. You're not on God's A team. You're on God's B, C, D. You haven't even made a team yet. And sometimes we say, yeah, that's right, that's right. Well, one of the things when we come to a time like this of communion, we have an opportunity to do what Jesus said, this do in remembrance of me. And we go back. We go back to that event of the cross. Jesus died on the cross. That's history. Jesus died for me. That's salvation. That's salvation. We've been studying in the book of Galatians in our adult Bible fellowship. And in that book, it says, Paul personalizes the gospel. He said, for I have been crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. That cross is a historical fact, but on it there's a personal message. He loved me. He died for me. That's why Jesus says, do this in remembrance of me. Remember what I did. Turn in your Bibles, if you will, to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Just a few thoughts before we partake this morning of the Lord's Supper. This is the Apostle Paul who is writing to this church at Corinth. It was a church that he had quite an impact on. It was a church that went through a lot of trouble. And Paul had to write what we call corrective letters to them to straighten them out on some things. And one of the issues that he's dealing with here regards the Lord's Supper. They had done what was not unusual in those days, is that when they would gather, they would have sort of a potluck. They called them love feasts. They would bring food along, and then as part of that, they would also celebrate the Lord's Supper at a particular time. And in bringing their food together, they ran into a problem, and that is this. As they would assemble and come, some would come very hungry, and very early on, they would, boom, devour the food. Others who came later got nothing. And so it was kind of a first come, first serve. It's kind of that saying we have, get there first before the greedy people do. You know, get there first. And that's what they did. And Paul is writing to him and he says, you shouldn't do it that way. That's not right. Christians should share, they should love, they should be generous, you should be considerate of one another. So he's dealt with that problem. And then he goes in to focus in on this, what we call the Lord's Supper or communion in itself. And I'm reading in chapter 11, verse 23. For I received from the Lord what I passed on to you. Notice, this is from the Lord. Paul says, Jesus gave this to me to pass on. And so this was instituted, or this was given by Jesus Christ himself. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, you notice it always points to that night as the night he was betrayed. All four Gospels list that. Paul listed here. That night was a night of betrayal. And I've wondered at times, why in the world is that always mentioned? Well, number one reason is because it was prophesied. It was prophesied that Jesus would be betrayed by one of his own. And it was a fulfillment of prophecy. But I think also there was a deep pain. There was a deep pain of being betrayed by one of the inner group. And I would say that many here today, you've experienced that, where some close friend, someone you've relied on, someone you have confidence in, someone you would never, ever think would let you down, let alone put a knife in your back, but they have. And there's probably nothing that's greater pain than to have someone like that that you think so much of, and they betray you. And that's part of the pain that Jesus suffered as he went to the cross, that one of his own would betray him. And so that night is referred to, the night he was betrayed. When he gave thanks, he broke that bread. This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is a new covenant in my blood. This is the new covenant. See, the old covenant was a way of with the law and many rules and regulations to keep. But this new covenant, this was salvation by faith in the blood of Jesus Christ that would be given on the cross. Whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. So Jesus instituted this, which we call the Lord's Supper. The Passover had celebrated deliverance from slavery in Egypt. And the Lord's Supper celebrates the deliverance from sin by Christ's death. Then he goes on and gives some instruction. He says, therefore, now this is the end of what Jesus said, therefore, whoever eats the bread, drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. In verse 26, as we participate, we find out that we're to do this very thoughtfully because we proclaim his death. We say something when we have this arranged and we have the service and we participate in the Lord's Supper. We are making a statement. We are proclaiming the death until Jesus comes back. We are anchoring our salvation in a historical event. And as I said, as we personalize it. There's something else here too. You notice in verse 27 that we're to do this very thoughtfully, very worthily. Therefore, whoever eats the bread, drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. We're to have due reverence and respect as we come to this time. A number of you know that our son, for 15 years, as he was growing up, decided that he wanted to live his life just the way he wanted to live. He parked his relationship with God and sought a life where he was the center. He did what he wanted to do, and that's the way he lived. Not uncommon today, unfortunately. During those 15 years, we maintained a good relationship. Jeff would attend church with us. And I noticed one thing. Whenever we attended services and communion was given, he never partook of communion. He knew enough and had enough respect and reverence for God. No, that is not for me, because that's not where I am in my relationship with God. We're to eat and drink in a worthy manner and not be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. And then we find out there's a self-examination that's to take place. A man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself. That's why many among you are so weak and sick. And a number of you have fallen asleep. But if we judged ourselves, we would not come under judgment. We have a choice. We can have a self-judgment with God. Search me, O God, know my heart, try me and know my thoughts, see if there be any wicked way in me, lead me in the way everlasting. God, show me. Put that spotlight down there so I can see sin and I can go to court and I can confess it before you and be acquitted, because you said if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins, to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. You will forgive and you will cleanse. We can do that. Or we can ignore it and let God do it for us. Isn't that interesting? If we judged ourselves, we would not come under judgment. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are being disciplined so that we will not be condemned with the world. God disciplines some of his children because it's the only way he can get their attention. Did you know that? Yeah, some bad things happen to Christians because it's the only way God can get their attention. That is not the way he wants to do it. He has another way, and that is, would you just come before me and make those corrections and confess any of that sin and deal with it, and it's done with, and we continue our walk? Some Christians say, no, I won't live that way. God loves them so much that he exercises discipline in order to get their attention. And they say, oh my, yes. So we're to have self-examination, go to court. And then you'll notice in verses 33 and 34, so then, my brothers, when you come together to eat, wait for each other. If anyone is hungry, he should eat at home, so that when you meet together, it may not result in judgment. So we're community and were considered one another as they were violating that. Now we're going to do something a little different today. As you can see, we have the bread and we have the cup here in front. And rather than distribute it, We're going to have a time of prayer, and then a time for you to personally prepare your own heart with any reflection, any confession you need to do before God. Maybe everything is right with you and God. You can just celebrate in the joy of walking with Him. And then we're going to let you just come forward. And you take the bread, you take the cup, and you take it back to your pew. You may want to come as individually, you may want as a couple, you may want to come as a family. And then go back and sit down. And then, as we do this, this might be a little uncomfortable for some of you. Say, oh my, come forward. I'd much rather sit here in my seat. But that's all right. You can just come forward. And, you know, we don't do this much here. Our faith is both a vertical and it's a horizontal expression. It's very much to God and it's very much to one another. One of the admonitions that Jesus gave us, He said, if you have aught with a brother, before you come, and give your gift, you should get that right, and then go worship God. So a time like this is even a time for us to make sure we're at peace with one another. And if you have something with somebody else, it's a time to make it right. Very simply, just get up and go. Say, I'm sorry. I said some harsh words. I'm sorry. I have not been the way I should be. This might be between a husband and wife. This might be between a parent and a child. Might be between some of the best of friends. So during this time, you can do that. You can do that. We're going to pray. Then you come. Father, here we are. We're your children. We're sons and daughters of Lord God Almighty. We're family. We've come to partake of what Jesus Himself has given us, what we call the Lord's Supper. Unworthy, yes, we are. But we thank you for His love, for His death. We thank you for the bread, His body given for us. We thank you for the cup, this New Testament, this whole new covenant that gives us righteousness, cleanses us, purifies us, and makes us sons and daughters of the Lord God Almighty. Thank you. So we come humbly to remember Jesus. Bless this time. Guide us, lead us. We pray in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Remember, He said it's a remembrance of me. It's that personal. It's not just an event. Yes, it's associated with an event, but it's personal. Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for going to the cross for us. Thank you for your death. Pain, the agony, the shame. Thank you for the love. Thank you for forgiveness and hope. Thank you that we have assurance. You promised you'll never leave us or forsake us. You've been there. Thank you. We rejoice in this. And we bless your holy name. May you be honored and praised as we continue to worship you in Jesus' name.